Tell them we were right. Tell them he really is coming. We just have to be patient and wait for him.
Sempre houve interesse muito grande no estudo das profecias por alguns indivíduos, mas não era algo tão generalizado.
Quando pensamos em Adventista, pensamos em Miller, que começou a pregar sobre a volta de Jesus no ano de 1871.
He had done what the Lord wanted him to do. You know what that was? To preach the message that was in the book of Daniel, that was closed until the time of the end. And now that we're in the time of the end, so the Lord revealed to this servant of God.
In 1815, William Miller, a war veteran, returns to his farm in the state of New York in search of peace. Though he was a theist, he finally understands that his quest for life's answers and concerns could only be solved through the Bible. At a time when the nation awakened for a new religious conscience, Miller's study of Bible prophecy revealed a truth that could not be kept secret. And even against his will, Miller becomes a preacher at a crucial point in history.
And that period was really the most religious period of American history, where people turned back to God, or to God in a special way. And it's interesting that that's the context of the Millerite movement, because William Miller becomes a Second Great Awakening preacher, but with a kind of unique message.
Miller preached that the second coming of Jesus was very close, and that will be a day of judgment.
Most Second Great Awakening preachers like Charles Finney and others looked at the millennium as 1,000 years of increasing peace in the earth until finally the glory of the Lord would fill the whole earth. So they had kind of a utopian approach to the work of God on earth. Miller had a very different view. He said, Jesus is soon to come. There's nothing we can do to make the earth the glory of God. We're looking for the soon second coming of Jesus, when he will appear in glory, and then he will destroy the earth and make a new earth, new heavens and new earth. So this is a radically different view.
É interessante que esse movimento, como eu mencionei, é interdenominacional. Pessoas de muitas denominações diferentes se uniram a ele, e ele não era uma igreja. Então você continuava sendo membro da sua igreja e aderiu a esse movimento.
Do ano de 1831 até o 1839, Miller estava pregando só em pequenas cidades, pequenas igrejas, até que ele foi convidado a pregar em Boston, no ano de 1839. Quando ele estava pregando lá, ele encontrou com um senhor chamado Josué Himes. E aquele homem pergunta para Miller, Miller, por que você prega só em cidade pequena, só em igreja pequena? Ele diz, eu prego onde sou convidado. E ele pergunta para Miller, posso eu te ajudar a fazer esse trabalho melhor? E Miller, sim, você pode. E esse Josué Himes começou a pegar os sermões de Miller e começou a espalhar e convidar Miller para ir para grandes cidades, grandes igrejas.
I've done some estimates, and Miller and the Millerite movement, Proclamation of the Soon Coming of Jesus, saturated New England and New York. Miller himself probably spoke, at least based on his recollections, to maybe 1 in 20 of the Americans living in New England and New York himself.
Nos próximos 4 ou 5 anos, eles espalham perto de 8 milhões de literatura. E pensar que naquele tempo nós tínhamos por volta de 20 milhões de pessoas vivendo aqui na América. O equivalente para 2 peças de literatura para cada casa na América do Norte.
E os cálculos são entre 50 a 100 mil adeptos formais, porque não havia um registro de membros ali. Mas Preuss, no seu livro The Burned Over District, ele menciona que além desse grupo, haviam cerca de 1 milhão de céticos expectantes.
On October 22nd of 1844, all those that have believed the message spread by William Miller were certain not only that Jesus will come back that day, but also that they will go to heaven with him. Some sold all that they have, others abandoned their businesses, and some others got together to wait for him who was to come. They waited till the last minute of that day, but Jesus did not come, in hope turning to disappointment. In the midst of sadness, pain, and doubt, some of them went back to the Bible searching for answers.
Some people just said, I've never believed it anyway. And they went back to whatever they'd been doing before. Some people continued to set new dates. Well, they were just disappointed again. Some people, maybe as many as 50, went back to their Bibles and dug and studied and find out the real truth that Jesus' work in heaven took on a new phase in preparation for coming. Some people asked William Miller what had happened. We didn't know. But he said, I have set my mind on another time, and there I intend to stand until he comes, and that is today, today, and today, until he comes.
William Miller lived certain that he will not await Christ's second coming in a place like this. Even in his last days, very ill and almost blind, he never lost sight of the assurance that one day he will see his Savior. Miller was buried in 1849. But the prophet Ellen White says that it is from this small cemetery in Lowhampton, New York, that he will see his Savior at the sound of the trumpet. Like Miller, many died believing in this hope, but the message of the soon coming of Jesus remains alive.
When he comes up, there'll be a little boy who was 18 years old, who used to come over here and think about Miller and his life, and he wanted what God wanted him to do. But he was killed in an accident. He was only in his teens, about 18, so he never knew. But his mother wanted him buried in the same graveyard as his friend. And that's where he is, right over there.
The night of October 22, 1844, came, and Jesus did not return as the Advent believers expected. But the next morning did, and it brought sadness, disappointment, and for some, even shame and humiliation.
And when he met a neighbor, they'd say, what are you doing here? I thought you were going up. And it sounds kind of funny, but it wouldn't feel funny, I don't think.
Why does God work out of disappointment? Could it be that disappointment is a filter, a grid, through which we pass, and in the passing through, there is something that gets purified. There's something that becomes resilient. There's something that shines. There is this phoenix out of the ashes. Now, out of that disappointment, our hearts are caught up with greater embrace and expectancy over what turns out to be God's methodical, patient unfolding of His divine will.
As he realized that Jesus was not coming back, a farmer named Hiram Edson and his friends gathered at his house on that October 22nd, wept bitterly. The next day, they went to the barn and prayed for heavenly guidance. Though in doubt, they were comforted and decided to go out and comfort other Adventists. It was on their way that Edson had an idea of what may have happened. In a way, it was here where the Adventist Church was born, when a farmer contemplated Christ.
I think the thing that we could say about Hiram Edson, he's someone who wanted to follow the Lord. He wanted to follow what God wanted him to do. He wanted the truth. And of course, after the disappointment, he has that experience of going through the cornfield. Some people call it a vision. I think that's pushing it. And this is how our sanctuary doctrine develops, the idea that Jesus didn't come back to earth in 1844, but he began a special end-time work in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary.
Essa doutrina é importante por uma razão muito simples e que o cristianismo perdeu de vista. A salvação, biblicamente, é sempre deriva do santuário.
One other truth already understood by a few Millerites before the great disappointment began to be assimilated and proclaimed after that October 22.
After the disappointment, out of the confusion of that disappointment, emerged Sabbatarian Adventism. We say Sabbatarian Adventism because they hadn't taken any name. That's just our name for them. They just called themselves Advent believers who kept the Sabbath.
Washington, New Hampshire is often credited as the birthplace of the Seventh-day Adventists. Some say it was here where it all began. When a group of people first embraced the faith on Christ's second coming and joined the Millerite movement, and then after listening to the testimony of a teacher named Rachel Oaks, also accepted the truth about the Sabbath. the small church over here that received James and Ellen White, John Andrews, and Joseph Bates remains to this day as a Seventh-day Adventist church.
But that church started just as a community church. It was a Christian church. Not Adventist, not even Sabbath-keeping. It was just a Christian, Sunday-keeping Christian church. But then it became a Millerite congregation before the disappointment. And of course, the stories that I'm sure you already looked at of Frederick Wheeler and Rachel Lokes, who comes there, and her daughter's teaching school, and she wants to be with her. She's a Seventh-day Baptist, and she introduces the Sabbath to Wheeler. And the others, at first they aren't interested, you know, but God helps Wheeler. Wheeler accepts it, and he becomes a very important early Sabbath keeper.
The truth about the Sabbath was published in a pamphlet that made its way to the hands of a man named Joseph Bates.
Joseph Bates was a sea traveler in a very interesting source of news for this whaler city. One time, as he was crossing the bridge that used to be in this exact same spot, he met his friend James Madison Monroe Hall. One time, James asked him, "Captain, where are the good news?" And he answered, "The good news is that the seventh day is the Lord's day." And that is how he shared the good news about the Sabbath.
Fairhaven is the home place of Joseph Bates. And of course, the three founders of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, Joseph Bates, James White, Ellen White, each played a role. Ellen White had a prophetic voice. We've talked about that. James White was the organizer, publisher, the mover and shaker of the movement. Joseph Bates in the early years was the theological founder. He's the one who was bringing together the theological framework in a very unique way. It's the Sabbath that comes finally through him, of course, to him and then through him in the movement. And then the sanctuary linking to the Sabbath is Joseph Bates again, this idea of the importance of proclaiming the Sabbath in the last days. These are theological core concepts that come from Joseph Bates.
Among those who experienced the great disappointment, a young girl received a special mission.
Every major epoch of sacred history has had a prophet who's saying, "Hey guys, something's about to happen." Now, look, would it be logical for a God who's done it here, 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 before the greatest event in the history of the human race, in other words, the return of Christ, visible, personal return of Christ to earth, would it be logical for God to say, "You know what? Yeah, I had him down here, but I don't need a friend now. You just figure it out. You people just figure it out. You'll get it." Can you imagine God doing that? Are you kidding? He's done it here, he's done it here, he's done it here. And so I believe that at the end of time, like John the Baptist, God says, "I'm going to have a friend." In fact, he found a 17-year-old girl, a 17-year-old American girl. And he says, "Hey, listen, I'm coming back. Would you be willing to tell the story?"
Was Ellen White the basis of the Seventh-day Adventist Church? It's not fair to say that. I teach development of SDA theology and teach these classes here at the seminary and have for a number of years. Ellen White is one of the founders of the church. That's fair to say. Her and James White and Joseph Bates. But they would never think or say that it's founded on her or even on her visions. Because a study of the movement shows that it was God leading them in their study of Scripture. So the movement was really message-driven from the Bible. And Ellen White saw her prophetic ministry as two things. And this is really important if people want to understand Ellen White and her role. She was there to take us to Jesus. Her emphasis upon Jesus and upon salvation is so powerful. And second is to take us to Scripture. So her writings take us to Scripture. They are not her writings. They're Scripture that she's pushing us to read and to look at. So it's not built on her. It's built on a biblical message.
I am absolutely convinced that the ministry of Ellen White, as a woman, is a ministry of a friend of God who brings to a generation who has ears for God the word, "Don't quit now."
As the days passed by and through a better understanding of the biblical commission, the Sabbath-keeping Adventists understood that the truths that they were finding had to be shared.
Só quem passou pelo desapontamento que pode ter uma ideia do que ele significou, porque o preconceito era muito grande. E eles romperam essa barreira, porque eles tinham esse senso de que eu tenho uma missão, eu pertenço a Deus, o mundo vai acabar e eu não estou interessado em acabar com ele. Eu quero estar comprometido com Deus e sua palavra.
They were looking, however, for something more than just newness. They actually wanted to be part of a New Testament style church. The great burden of many of these religious groups was to go back to the first century, the primitive church, as they called it. And various expressions of that primitive church were springing up. Adventism had this same strong impulse. How do we bring back biblical Christianity before centuries of tradition and culture got layered on top of it? What did biblical Christianity look like? What were its practices? Most importantly, what did it believe? What did Jesus teach?
Following the example of Jesus, who dedicated time teaching, they developed methods to study the Bible and to share what they were finding. One of these mediums was Sabbath school, which started even before the church was formally organized.
When Millerism first began, Sabbath schools were being conducted in Protestant churches, Baptist, Methodist, others of that nature, to help children, again, who were not in school. They called them Sabbath schools, even though they worshiped on Sunday. In the 19th century, many of the Protestant churches did that. Over the time, they changed to call it Sunday school. But anyway, when Millerism began in the 1820s to 30s and 40s, there was an interest in also beginning to help children. So when James White, in 1852, he thought it would be a good idea to write some Sabbath school lessons for children. And those first Sabbath school lessons that he wrote were for children and for youth, not for adults. He wrote four Sabbath school lessons, published for the first time in 1852 in the publication called The Youth Instructor. And so Bible study is at the very core of the goals for Sabbath school, but there are others. There are fellowship and outreach and emphasis on mission.
In 1849, James White said, "The message must fly because the time is short." Inspired by this statement, and as the missionary spirit filled the hearts of the Adventist people, in 1869, a group of ladies here in South Lancaster, led by Roxy Rice, found a way to pray, visit the neighbors, and help the people in need. Also, they sent by mail thousands of pamphlets and books to share the gospel around the world. Today, the Adventist Church serves with this same spirit through hospitals, schools, media in different institutions sharing the message of Christ's second coming.
Como começou publicações dentro da igreja? Dentro da igreja começou em 1848, quando a Ellen White recebeu a primeira visão. E na visão, o esposo dela estava para sair para cortar feno em uma fazenda para ganhar dinheiro para visitar os primeiros adventistas dentro da América. É quando Ellen White é tomada em visão. E depois da visão, ela diz para o seu esposo: "Eu tenho uma mensagem para você. Você deve parar e começar a escrever, imprimir e mandar ao povo."
The way you drew attention to any new faith group or to the teachings of Scripture that you believed in was to publish a paper. And in fact, Adventists very soon discovered that in order to gather together and coalesce those who still hung on to the beliefs of Jesus soon coming, they needed a paper. That first little magazine, only 8 pages, very small, was published in 1849 in Rocky Hill, Connecticut. It probably had only about 3,000 persons who it even could have gone to, and the first numbers were certainly restricted even to a smaller group. But it began to do its work quickly. People began to see in this little magazine a place to express their faith, their hope, and their questions.
Since it started, the communication between Adventists served not only to inform, but also as a way to keep the family together.
The Seventh-day Adventist Church is a global family. There are many, many Christian churches that have a sort of very loose linkage internationally, and they tend to be somewhat independent local churches or national churches. We are not. We are a tightly bonded family around the world. And we share faith, we share our resources, and when we think and plan mission, we share with the church globally.
One of the most plaintive letters I have ever read in the review was in the mid-1850s from a young woman living out in Iowa, today in the central United States, but it was the frontier in the 1850s. And she writes, "I am, so far as I know, the only Adventist in my county, and I am very lonely, and I look to the pages of the review to find my church."
In the very early days, Adventists had a very limited view of mission. They thought that it extended to the Pacific Ocean and then to the Atlantic Ocean in the United States. They saw that the United States was a melting pot of different immigrants coming in, and they thought that when you read Matthew chapter 28 and it says, "Go ye into all the world," then we can do it right here in North America.
No começo do movimento adventista, nós temos inclusive a teoria ou a teologia da porta fechada, ou seja, a porta já está fechada, não vai ninguém mais se converter. Então, para os que estão dentro, está tudo bem. Depois, quando se começou realmente a estudar muito mais as escrituras, viram-se que, de repente, a porta poderia se abrir um pouquinho mais, não só para os do movimento adventista, como aqueles que tinham filosofias em comum, como os batistas, os presbiterianos que vieram da reforma. Depois foi abrindo muito mais. Então você vê que entre 1843-44, né, na época do movimento millerita, do desapontamento, até 1863, que nós estamos fazendo 150 anos agora, né, da organização oficial da igreja, ninguém se falou praticamente em enviar missionários. O primeiro missionário foi só enviado praticamente 10 anos depois.
But then their vision expanded and they realized that when Matthew 28 says, "Go ye into all the world," it means go ye into all the world. And so you see in the 1870s that missionaries started going to Europe, then in the 1880s to the other major continents, and then the church just didn't stop. It just kept growing. It kept expanding its vision for taking the good news about Jesus to all the world.
The essence of the movement was in the mission. This was the element that made the Adventist message spread rapidly.
We are a missionary church, but it concerns me that as we grow, we become more institutionalized, and there is a tendency to start looking inward. So we start looking at how do we maintain what we have, how do we keep the saints happy, and it's very easy to lose that focus of we're actually here with a mission to share Christ's love to the community. And so our local churches, when we look at our budgets, are we spending more money on keeping ourselves happy with all our resources and a nice church building, or are we putting our resources to connect to the community? We have to ask that as a world church as well. You know, Christians have a tendency to put most of their resources where there are already Christians. But our focus needs to be, how do we take this good news outside of the parameters we've already established and actually reach new people groups and new geographical areas.
The sense of mission led the initiatives of the Seventh-day Adventists for more than 150 years. However, the greatest challenge is to keep the missionary spirit despite the growth and even as time goes by.
Now the problem is, if we are not involved in mission, we become a pew warmer. We become a member of a religious social club where we come to church on Sabbath morning. We pray, we sing nice songs, we shake hands and smile and have a nice time, then we go home and that's it. That is playing a game. And when we find churches that are fighting with each other, arguing over the worship service, arguing over theology, I can guarantee you that 99% of the time they are not focused on mission. Because when we open up the doors of the church and we open up the windows, we see a community in need, that's where our focus is in. And as we become involved in mission, we ourselves are changed. We're not only blessing the community, we ourselves are spiritually enriched.
Since the beginning, Seventh-day Adventists committed themselves to be more than a religious society. Article 5 of the 1863 General Conference Constitution required the Executive Committee to act as a missionary board. In 1874, Jay and Andrews departed as the church's first official missionary, worked for 9 years in Europe, and died in the field. Andrews asked that no eulogy was written because he believed that focus should be in the mission and not on the missionary. The reluctant, the editors of the review agreed. Nevertheless, a great eulogy continues to be written as many young people and families leave places like this university that carries his name to take the message all around the world as he once did.
Ele foi escolhido para ser o patrono, diria, dessa universidade porque por causa de duas características. O primeiro, ele foi o primeiro missionário adventista. E o segundo, porque ele foi o primeiro erudito ou estudioso adventista de uma certa envergadura, né? E eu diria que hoje eu vejo os jovens missionários, mas eu vejo que falta a parte do erudito, dos estudos. Então, o espírito dos pioneiros hoje seria essa aliar, né? Essa parte missionária de força de atividade com a parte de reflexão, estudo e o que hoje a universidade chama de pesquisa.
Se existe um movimento adventista, é porque também existe uma missão de Deus para esse movimento.
I am firmly convinced. I have been. I've lived for this my whole life. This is God's people. God is going to see us through the full journey. He is going to take us home. Not a shadow of doubt about that. We have to be sure that on the way, while we are still here, that we are doing the things that God has asked us to do.
It's pretty hard to ask a generation to relate to the past. We don't ask them to relate to Abraham Lincoln. We don't ask them to relate to George Washington in our nation. You have your great historical figures in Brazil and in South America. We don't ask a generation to relate, but we ask a generation to examine. Because history unlearned is history repeated. We have to know what made us who we are, politically as a nation and spiritually as a people.
Every time I drive into this town, my thoughts go back to what God did in this place in raising up this church.
This was frontier of America at that time. And so you'd have a few settlers that lived a long distance apart. There wasn't a town or a city as we know it now until into the 1850s.
Battle Creek gets its name from a battle between two surveyors and two Native Americans, or they called them Indians, Potawatomi Indians, in 1825. And I don't think anybody got killed from what I've read. I think one of the Indians maybe got injured, but the two surveyors, when they went back to the rest of their survey party, they were laying out the lines and all that for the official surveys for plat maps and all that. They decided to call this Battle Creek after this great battle with four people.
It was the headquarters clear up until this reorganization of the General Conference, and the problems that happened. There were two major fires, the destruction of the sanitarium and the publishing house, and they realized they needed to decentralize. It's a part of this decentralizing, and the General Conference moved to Tacoma Park, really in Washington, D.C. But between 55 and the move, there over almost half a century, Battle Creek was where everything was happening in the growing and emergence of Adventism.
Well, when James White came here, we didn't have a church yet. So let's say 1852 to 1902, 1903, when we moved to Washington after the fires of 1902. This is the nucleus of the church, where the Preuss was, where James White was, even though he wasn't president all those years, but where James White was. Ellen White was here many of those years. This was the center of the activity for the church. And then, of course, this is where we organized. We organized the publishing house here in 1860. We organized our very first conference, the Michigan Conference for the state of Michigan, 1861. 1863, we organized the General Conference here. So then it becomes the official headquarters of the church from 1863 till 1903, the General Conference was here. So it was the center of Adventism. We had the Review was here, the Review and Herald Publishing Association. We had the sanitarium, started out as the Health Reform Institute, became the Battle Creek Sanitarium. We had the Battle Creek College. So we had all of our major institutions were here, all within about two blocks of each other.
Of course, Adventists became a very big part of Battle Creek. Almost all of them lived on the west side of town, the West End as they called it. In fact, many people called it Advent Town. And so pretty much everything west of the sanitarium in town with Seventh-day Adventists?
Well, the Sabbath keepers eventually, not initially, really put this place on the map.
It was in a meeting house just like this one that the Seventh-day Adventist Church chose its name and decided to be organized as an institution. This is a replica of the Second Adventist Church in Battle Creek. Although it was used as a church, the pioneers chose to call it Meeting House because in it they discussed different matters. It was in one of those meetings on May of 1863 that the church leaders decided that it was time to be organized and created the General Conference.
I mean, they took their religion seriously in those days. Believe me, it was serious business. And they thought about every nuance and everything that they were going to decide to do. They had to debate it and discuss it and pray about it and debate it and discuss it and pray about it again.
Battle Creek also has in it stories that are difficult to tell. Stories of prominent Seventh-day Adventist leaders who left the faith, often because they couldn't take counsel from their brethren. They were so independent-minded that they could not function as part of a common faith group. Those things are also part of what we remember when we come here. It's not just the good things that God has done, it's the things we have learned from our own mistakes as the Holy Spirit has prompted us to make changes organizationally and to develop a way of working together as a group of leaders.
There's a lot of memories for people that know our history, a lot of lessons that can be learned from things that happened here. When we followed the counsels of God through the years, we prospered and grew. Other times we didn't.
We need to know, what has God done in the past? Really, once we see the hand of God in the past, we have nothing to fear for the future, except that we forget what He was doing in the past. So that's why every one of these stained glass windows is in dedication to one of the pioneers. It has a little plaque under it, and it names the pioneer. Why? Just to be reminded. We stand on some very broad shoulders. This thing didn't get invented with you and me. Are you kidding? We've got generations behind us who have, out of great sacrifice, incredible losses. I mean, you have South American missionaries who've gone around the world who have given their lives on foreign shores for the sake of the kingdom of Christ. We have that in our country. We stand on their shoulders. We cannot forget them. Their reminder to us is, even as they were faithful, we too must be faithful to the same Lord Jesus. So in that way, pioneers are important. We can't identify with them. We don't have to. We stand on their shoulders instead.
Core values, such as freedom and independence, were predominant in the establishment of the United States as a nation, as well as in the structuring of religious movements, such as Adventism.
America's revolution in the late 18th century implanted this idea of being suspicious of monarchies, of emperors, of powers, of higher authorities in ecclesiastical organizations or in government. And so Americans who were attracted to Adventism were also suspicious of organizations that exercised heavy top-down control. By the time that the Adventist Review began publishing, a discussion sprang up within a few years about whether we needed even some form of church organization. Many, many of the review readers said absolutely not.
Why were they opposed? Well, they had just come out of the Millerite movement. And in the Millerite movement, their belief in the soon coming of Jesus had caused the normal churches, the regular churches, Methodist, you know, Baptist, Christian Connection, whoever it might be, to reject them. And so those were churches, they thought, that had a creed and were formal, and like Babylon.
Porque no início de 1844, George Storrs diz que nenhuma igreja pode ser organizada por vontade humana sem que se torne Babilônia no momento de sua organização. Então havia uma resistência a qualquer forma de organização e até mesmo a escolha de um nome.
But James White said no. And Ellen White said, no, this is different. We're organizing with a mission.
Once it became clear that we had a global responsibility in mission, that we had to take this around the world, it also became clear to us that we must have an organization which is equally global. Because we have to hold together, we have to be sure that we stay as one family.
So why did we organize? This is a question people have asked. What caused us to organize? Well, it was James White, really, who was much the leader in this. And it really is a convergence of issues. Perhaps the immediate issue was the publishing work.
A nossa editora estava em nome de Tiago White. E se ele morresse, o que que aconteceria? Então ele queria colocar isso em nome da igreja. Só que para colocar em nome da igreja, não tem como registrar uma editora em uma igreja sem nome. Então foi exatamente o fato de nós organizarmos a obra de publicações, ou mais especificamente a nossa editora, que levou à escolha de um nome, que forçou esse processo e que acabou ocorrendo no dia 1 de outubro de 1860.
The other issues that were affecting us were the rapidly approaching Civil War. And of course, as we moved into the Civil War, the need to organize made it possible for us to represent the church. And then a third thing was the group was big enough. There were so many ministers. At first, James White was just passing money to people, saying, well, you need some money, here's some money. But he couldn't get money to all the right people. And so there were people who were hungry and their families were hungry. They didn't have a system to make it work.
The need for a structure that would direct the movement in an organized way became not only evident, but urgent.
When they formed the General Conference in May of 1863, now exactly 150 years ago, they concluded that while they would have a president, he would have only a one-year term. They would have a strong committee, and the church would really effectively be run by committees rather than individuals. They believed that power distributed in the group was safer for God's people. And there's good reason for that. Today, when you walk in the General Conference building, I often take visitors down to the main floor and look up at the atrium, they call it, and I say, what is the most prominent architectural feature you see in this building? And they say, committee rooms. And I say, precisely.
Nós fomos uma fusão, praticamente, entre o modelo metodista, de ter uma associação geral, e também presbiteriano um pouco, e houve essa, eu creio que uma convergência de diferentes modelos, e foi mais uma decisão pragmática e não tão teórica. Agora nós vamos estudar os modelos organizacionais existentes e vamos optar por um. Eu acho que foi mais uma questão, nós precisamos de alguma coisa que nos integre, que nos mantenha juntos, e vamos fazer dessa maneira. Então houve essa fusão de diferentes modelos com pastores itinerantes, uma característica do metodismo. Depois você tem essa questão de eliminar o rol de membros da igreja, ou seja, manter um registro, uma coisa mais séria nesse sentido. E você tem as associações e essa integração geral. Então é um modelo, eu creio que, fusão de vários e que se tornou singular para nós. Não tem outra igreja igual.
Adventism is, I would say, virtually unique. There may be one or two others like it, but it is virtually unique among major world faiths for its unified structure worldwide. Most other Christian faiths have adopted very regional systems in which the church in one country or the church in one region is largely autonomous. It may have friendly relationships with the church in another country. They may federate on certain things, but they run their own life internally. Adventism said from the first that because the truth of Scripture calls for one body, that worldwide expression of the faith that grew up from Scripture needed to be connected in a unique way.
And I think the Seventh-day Adventist Church's structure globally is the envy of many other churches. I mean, there are ministers of other churches, for example, our tithing system and our sharing of resources, who've said to me when I was president many times, I wish our church had a system like yours, where we share resources and where our members are much more involved financially in the life of the church. We do this globally, and that is made possible because of the fact that we have both the conviction that this is God's plan, but the fact that we are a global organization that holds together.
Every year, the General Conference delegates meet at two different times. These delegates, representing each of the church's 13 world divisions, gather to discuss church policies, listen to reports, and vote on different matters. Most of their time is spent on committees, sharing their opinions, and voting on decisions that will affect not only their division, but the world church.
That is the heart of the Seventh-day Adventist understanding of governance. If you cannot persuade other people of the merits of your ideas will go nowhere in this church. If you cannot work with a committee, you will not have influence. This church is founded on the principle of us.
It was my privilege to serve the church as the world president for 11 years. That was a spiritual assignment. The model is not the White House. The model is not General Motors. The model is Christ.
It's a very humbling experience, and you recognize that you really don't have many answers, and you have to lean on the Lord an awful lot. You know, I pray a lot and study, ask the Lord to guide, plead with the Holy Spirit to be present in my life. I try to claim James 1:5 every day, that if you lack wisdom, God will give it to you. It's not an easy job, but then again, if you stay true to God's word and to the instruction in the spirit of prophecy, and you just open your heart to the Lord and say, Lord, lead me, you have to believe that He'll do that.
Eu costumo dizer que o problema da igreja não é o secularismo do mundo. É quando o secularismo do mundo entra na igreja e quando essa secularização da igreja atinge o ministério e talvez a sua liderança. Então, se a organização da igreja é mais uma entidade de gerenciamento de pessoas e de recursos financeiros, não existe muita necessidade, porque em realidade o objetivo da organização é manter a unidade da fé e facilitar o cumprimento da missão. Então, todos os níveis organizacionais da igreja deveriam trabalhar para a missão, serem entidades de desenvolvimento de projetos, de estratégias, de levar avante a missão na sua região, porque o conceito de desenvolvimento estratégico e também de planificação de um lugar pode não dar certo para outro, então nós precisamos contextualizar as estratégias mantendo clara a nossa mensagem.
We take our business very seriously and we practice transparency and integrity. We are not about to hide any information from members of the church. And for that reason, any member of the church has access to information pertaining to the growth of the church. All the statistics, they have to do with world divisions, the unions, conferences, are all on the website. And the website can be found in the Office of Archives, Statistics and Research at the General Conference website. It is accessible to all. In fact, the statistics go back for many years.
A congregation of 17,500,000 official members, a message shared in 924 languages and dialects, and more than 230,000 people that work full-time in different fields, in order to accomplish only one purpose, to announce to every people, every language, every tribe, and every nation that Jesus is coming back soon.
The United Nations officially has about 230 official countries in the world. Seventh-day Adventists have entered about 202 out of the 230. So they like to say that the Seventh-day Adventist Church is like Coca-Cola. Where you can find Coca-Cola, you can find the Seventh-day Adventist Church, the most widespread church in the world.
That which binds this church together is first and foremost the spiritual unity which ties us as one. It's a spiritual phenomenon that binds this church. Then we can look at some other details. Yes, the shared doctrines. We have the same value system, if you wish, both in terms of our ethics and moral values, and in terms of the biblical doctrines we hold to. We have them in common around the world.
Seventh-day Adventist Church, as far as I'm concerned,
is a movement that has been raised up by God. Our history has been prophesied in the Bible, especially in the book of Revelation. So the church has been founded on ashes. We rose from ashes because of the great disappointment in 1844, October 22. And so it's a church that has been prophesied a long time ago. So it is God's end time movement for a dying world. The last movement that has the privilege of bringing three angels' messages to the world before the world is burnt up. And that's the reason why we need to be very focused. Why do we exist as an organization?
We are a movement that's connected to prophecy. It really goes back to 1844 and everything that's happened since then. And of course, the exciting thing is it's still the second coming of Jesus that we're looking for. And that's the next thing. And so everything is focused on that, and we're just getting closer and closer. And so to understand how God has worked in the whole movement gives us energy, gives us confidence, it gives us certainty, it gives us hope, and it helps us understand our mission better. So there's just so many things, and it can encourage us. It can also correct us when we start to get off. So this is a blessing that God can do for us, I think, as we look at our history.
A big part of the history of the Seventh-day Adventists was preserved and is stored here in the vault of the Church's World Headquarters in the United States. More than 60,000 original pages, 5,000 letters, and 4,600 articles exist, many of them written by the prophet's own hand.
Our history, our Seventh-day Adventist history, is not the Bible, of course, but it's still a story of the working of God in events. And that makes it important history because of its providential connection. So as we look at how God worked in our history, we are helped in our experience today. It helps us understand our identity, our mission, our message, and love God more.
O que é a igreja? A igreja é a somatória de todos aqueles que fazem parte dela. Se todos se unem e focam na missão, a igreja é forte, a igreja cumpre a missão. Se a igreja estrutura, está cheia de projetos, mas a igreja membros não está comprometida com isso, nada disso vai passar dos gabinetes, dos escritórios, das reuniões de planejamento. E o que hoje Deus espera de nós não é mais planos, não é mais escritórios, mais edifício ou mais estrutura. É mais poder para cumprir a missão. E isso cada um de nós tem que receber, cada um de nós tem que se comprometer, porque Deus espera usar cada membro para cumprir toda a missão.
Agora, Ellen White também diz o seguinte: muitas pessoas creem que no final dos tempos nós vamos avançar sem qualquer organização. Mas ela diz, na obra de Deus não existe qualquer coisa como avançar sem uma organização. Então, que um dia ela vai acabar, sim. Mas isso é uma questão que Deus vai tratar disso. Não sou eu que vou agora profetizar quando isso vai acontecer, se vai ser depois do fechamento da Porta da Graça, como vai ser. Enquanto isso, nossa missão é trabalhar juntos e de maneira organizada.
Ellen White says in the book Early Writings that there's never been a revival and reformation in this country before or since that has compared with what happened then. But just shortly before Jesus comes again, there will be a revival and reformation far greater than what took place then. And I think that day is soon.
O problema é que a gente fica dividido. A gente quer aproveitar a vida e não quer vestir a camiseta. Mas se a gente se dedicar mesmo, o que precisa é de uma intencionalidade e um entusiasmo. É como disse alguém, é perigoso você falar com alguém que se entusiasma por algo porque se torna muito convincente.
When we share the good news of Jesus Christ in different contexts, we need to translate the message. So the way that I would talk about Christianity to a Buddhist in Thailand is a different way to how I would talk about the Adventist message to a non-believing atheist New York investment banker.
Our most significant paradigm that we offer Christian thinking is a great controversy motif. In other words, we believe that this universe has a history long before us, that in God's perfect universe and creation, there once was a civil war, a rebellion of His children, one-third of the angels, rebelling against the Father, that the earth is set from its beginning in the midst of that civil war that we call the Great Controversy, the Great War, and that what is playing out today on this planet is in fact the intense cosmic warfare between the forces of love and light, forces of darkness and hatred. Those forces are playing out their strategic move for the allegiance of the human race.
But the principle remains the same. I don't care in which context you're preaching, which continent of the world, what people group, we need to follow Christ's method. And Ellen White summarized Christ's method as a five-stage step. Number one, Jesus mingled with people. He made friends with people. Secondly, He showed sympathy to them. Thirdly, He ministered to their needs. Fourth, He won their confidence. And then He bid people to follow Jesus. That is the formula that Ellen White says will give true success. She says it's the only method that will bring true success. The problem is that as Adventists, we sometimes want the quick results. We want the baptismal figures that we can put on Nova Tempo or put on the review or the magazine. And so we go straight to step number five and we preach the gospel, when often we haven't earned the right to do so. We haven't taken those four steps. We haven't mingled. We haven't shown sympathy. We haven't ministered to needs. And we certainly haven't won confidence. And then we ask ourselves, why are so many people leaving the church? And part of the reason is we haven't followed Christ's method. People have come in with a head knowledge. They've been convinced intellectually. But the bond hasn't been built because we haven't followed Christ's method.
The other unique teaching, Bible teaching, that we espouse, that we share, is the teaching of an end-time judgment. We call it a pre-Advent judgment. We believe that Jesus is not only Lord of the Sabbath, He's not only Lord of salvation, because He gave the Sabbath first, then He came, he became our Savior, but He's also Lord of the sanctuary. There is an end game. God has an end-time move to bring this whole tragic story of rebellion to a finale, to an ending. And so what's taking place, we believe, in the heavenly sanctuary, in God's temple today, is that wrap-up. God is strategically moving all the pieces on this chessboard to His last move. There's no other denomination that teaches that. Every other denomination teaches, yes, we got creation, yes, of course, we have Calvary, and now we're waiting for the coming. But we're saying, no, before the coming, God is going to settle this great controversy, this huge debate. Is He trustworthy? Is He a God of love? He will settle that controversy once and for all. And so there is this pre-Advent, before He comes, judgment, where Jesus grants to every human being the choice he or she has made. Yes to Him or no to Him. He grants us that freedom to choose. Once that choice is ratified, the end brings this sad and tragic story to its ending.
Se eu sei que Jesus vai voltar em meus dias, eu vou me concentrar completamente nessa missão. A gente até acredita que Jesus vai voltar em nossos dias, mas o nosso estilo de vida, o nosso desempenho parece que não endossa essa crença que eu tenho.
People think, oh, end of the world, we got time, we only have 5 feet of water on this planet. I want to tell you something. The last 5 minutes are critical because everything is doubling. It just keeps doubling. We're running out of oil. We're running into debt. The human population is just going psh. All the graphs are going like this. We don't have. You can't say to me, oh, Dwight, it's the same as 150 years ago. Why worry? Are you crazy? This planet is running out while we're sitting here. The point is, the world cannot exist at this rate, indefinitely.
Acho que a nossa mensagem não deve mudar, muito pelo contrário, ela precisa se tornar mais forte e mais tocante. O povo vai acostumando com este mundo, a igreja vai acostumando com essa terra, a sociedade está entretida com tantas coisas. Nós precisamos tornar a mensagem da volta de Cristo mais relevante para alcançar as pessoas que vivem com a cabeça de hoje. Por que Cristo não voltou, eu não sei. Mas nós precisamos pregar com mais força para que não demore outros 150 anos até que ele venha.
The decision when should Christ come back is a sovereign decision that God makes. God has his own plans, his own objectives. God has a cosmic whole, much, much larger creation than just this world to keep in mind. God looks at everything, but the time will come when he says, this is it. We've done everything we can. Let's close this chapter. It will come. That is the certain message of Scripture. To begin to speculate about time, will we be here 5 years more, 10 years more? It's a waste of energy. And frankly, I don't care how many more years. I want to be faithful today because I don't know whether I shall be here tomorrow to do it. So for me, faithfulness today is what matters. And that I make the decisions for God to be loyal and true in what I do now. If he comes tomorrow, wonderful. If I shall rest in the grave, if my children, my grandchildren will rest in the grave, okay, that's fine. When we wake up, he will come. So time to me is not an issue. Faithfulness is the important thing.
Day when you see a cloud in the sky, a little size of a fist, that's what I talked about, and it grows and grows, and then you'll see Jesus come.